Hey guys, well, it looks like we've had a fair bit of rainfall overnight. I would say a huge amount, to be honest with you. But you know what? Everything is feeling really alive, really green, and really vibrant. And you can smell along the trail the most amazing fragrance of bluebells where we've had that rain. It's brought everything alive. And it's just there hanging in the air. So, yeah, it feels really, really vibrant. And I've just had the most amazing encounter not long back up on the trail, past this most beautiful, wonderful Saxon church. And there in the distance, as I kind of turned onto the trail, I could see this mass of cyclists. And then I thought to myself, that's odd. I could hear this kind of yak bell in the distance, a faint sound of a yak bell, which absolutely made me smile, made me chuckle. And as these guys approached, they had yak bells attached to their panniers, and it was a group of elderly cyclists that have toured all the way from the Netherlands, and they're on their way to London. And they're on their last day. They've got around about 40 odd miles to go, and they'll be at journey's end and day's end. And it was so wonderful to briefly share an exchange, share some of the story, some of their experience. And I think that's what I love about all of this is the shared experience, the stories that people have to share. You know, they've got stories to why they're doing it, where they've come from, where they're going, and what they've encountered along the way. And I absolutely love that. You know, that to me is what all of this is about, is the shared experiences and the shared stories. So, with that point made, I really kind of want to share a experience with you, a story of two halves in many ways, that goes back a fair long way. It goes back to the beginning of my journey at least, which stretches back around about 25 years. Now, many of you know, I am working on my project, The Long Road Home. And I'm really kind of bringing all that together now and I'm really enjoying that process. But it's kind of stirred up, and maybe, you know, it's stirred up some of the memories, some of the stuff there in the subconscious. But as I kind of move through this, and as spirit meets adventure kind of finds its own place in the world, one of the things that I've really experienced is that as you move into alignment, and you move a little bit deeper into alignment, so much begins to kind of fall into place. Even down to a few weeks ago, again along this trail that I do a fair lot of cycling in preparation for all that we do, and really kind of helps me with my own physical challenges that I've had. I found this poster there sitting up on a notice board, and one other sitting by the Saxon Church. About a food for free course on wild food and foraging, and I thought that's going to be absolutely amazing. And again, just pops up out of nowhere. It's going to be a very useful experience, especially as we'll be able to take some of that, not all of it, but some of it, and integrate it for a journey and an expedition at the end of the towards the end of the year, towards the end of summer, up in the Highlands, up the Caledonian Canal. So, yeah, things do fall into place. So, story I've got to share with you, fascinating story. So it stretches back around 25 years or so, and it is my pilgrimage. I believe that it was my rite of passage when I went up into the Highlands for the first time, and I walked across those mountains. One of the things that it greatly gave me is, as many of you know, is it kind of bestowed this sense of self. You know, as many of you know, I've shared, I kind of experienced this sense of loss and feeling lost. And then as the journey unfolded, I kind of faced myself, and I found this sense of self. Now, one of the experiences that happened during that time that's really come full circle now, only in the last week or so. I was just laughing because I've just seen a raven, and that makes sense as we go forwards. As Yeah, the last few weeks it's really kind of come together really, really whole and really complete. So I was up in the Highlands taking that pilgrimage, rite of passage, which I think that, you know, in many ways, just maybe it's something that we all should do at one point in our lives. And I think early on in life, or even later, but what it bestows, what it fosters, what it nurtures is it gives you a sense of self. And I think that's probably why, you know, some of the other cultures around the world have kind of really interwoven it into their culture. You know, take the Aborigines walkabout, for instance, and it was a rite of passage to find oneself, so that as you move forward in life, you've got that sense of foundation. So, you know, I'm a real great ambassador for taking pilgrimage, taking a rite of passage, taking a solo journey of substance to kind of discover who you are. You know, many university graduates do it. After graduating, they travel the world, and it is, you know, it's a rite of passage. So I was there in the Highlands, and I was having at times very unusual, very odd, and very strange dreams at the time. And one of the dreams that was coming, and it comes several times while I was in the Highlands, was of this very tall man wearing a real dark brimmed hat. Okay, and his brimmed hat was so kind of wide you couldn't quite make out his eyes. You can make out some of his facial features, a beard, very kind of archetypal character. Almost as if he seemed like a Gandalf type character, but the thing is, he was a little bit more, well, a lot more sterner than this, and kind of had this really rawness to him, almost this stern, almost kind of anger, but warm feeling, very, very unusual, untangible feeling, but very tangible at the same time. So he's kind of real raw and really, really wild, but there was a warmth to him, almost like could feel this warmth being emanated from him. Almost very parental, very kind of wanting to kind of, in a way, I feel, show me something. And I would see him in my dream, but he was always searching for something, always kind of looking for someone, always seemed like he was going somewhere. Very much a wanderer is the feeling I got from him. And he would often point towards this tree. Now, in this tree, there were these strange markings. Couldn't quite make them out, never seen them before in my life at that point. But I felt they were of importance, felt the whole dream was important. I'd wake up and it would still be there in my awareness. It would still very be there during the day as the day unfolded. The heavens had just opened up, but I'm sitting under this lovely canopy of trees, so nice and dry. And I kind of got this sense of, you know, it was of great importance, this dream. Now, as the journey unfolded, you know, I shared with some of you, you know, the experience around the calm stones, and I was kind of drawn to these calm stones. And one particular day, as I crossed this very, very narrow wooden type bridge, there at the end of it, I could make out this lone standing stone. But as I approached it, all the way around the edge of it, was these markings. Now, the markings I had seen within the dream, but I didn't understand what they were. But when I kind of looked at this stone, it felt as if it was trying to tell me something. It felt in a way kind of oddly familiar, and the markings felt familiar for the dream. So as time went by, this kind of sense, this kind of presence would still be with me during the day, and it never left me. It would always kind of be there within my awareness. I'm coming back from the Highlands, from Scotland was quite a journey in itself, because, you know, the world seemed busier. It definitely seems a lot noisier, as I'm going to share within the book, The Long Road Home. But it was everything seemed to be a lot noisier, a lot busier, as it would be. But I found myself at least once a week going to this wonderful bookshop called Otica's. Some of you may remember it going back, but I go back to Otica's, and there's a little cafe, little coffee shop, and I kind of spend a bit of time there at least once a week. And I approached the bookshelf. It's not the first time this sort of thing has happened to me, but I approached the bookshelf, and there was this book, the Book of Runes, by Ralph Blum, and it absolutely stood out at me because there on the book there were markings of what I now know to be the runes, and I was absolutely completely fascinated by it. But you know what I was really fascinated really by was Ralph's approach and his story to how the runes come into his life. He shared his most wonderful story in an interview that I'd seen, and what he said was that he had spent some time in England. He come from Connecticut, and he spent some time in England doing a research trip. He met this lady in Red Hill, which is not a million miles away from where we are, and she had handed to him a rune set and a kind of a book on runes. And one particular night, and it was a very difficult time within his life he was going through, he had just recently separated from his wife, and he was dusting the shelf, library books he had in his shelf, and he's dusting them off, and there fell off the shelf into his hands was the bag of runes. And he thought to himself, you know, hold on a minute, in what order did you come? There he was, you know, he'd lost, he separated from his relationship, he'd lost his job, he was feeling a very low point in his life, and now he was talking to a set of stones. And it kind of made me chuckle, made me laugh, and it kind of deeply resonated with me, because what he went on to say was that actually, you know, you don't find the runes find you. And that really deeply resonated with me because the experience I had in Scotland. Now, time went past and I kind of brought myself a set of runes. I kind of started to explore with them, started working with them, would kind of consult them for people around me, and they started to speak to me. Things started to happen with them, and then, you know, my journey progressed onto the cards, and then the mediumship really opened up, and the runes kind of took a back seat in so many ways. But somehow my journey hadn't quite finished with them. And in one particular day I was talking about this lone figure that would appear at times within my life, with the wide brimmed hat, with the beard, and I couldn't see his eyes. And I felt this immense strength coming off him, almost this wildness from him. And this sense of him wandering, you know, was something that really jumped out at me. And I shared it with a good friend of mine who had a real understanding on the Celtic mythology and the traditions of our lands. And she said, you know who this Gandalf type character is, don't you? You know, because it had the qualities of Gandalf, but not. She says, you know who this is, don't you? And I said, no, I have no idea. And it's associated with rune saying, yes? I said, yeah, always seems to show me the rune markings. Well, Shane, that's Odin. And that to me was really kind of hard to get my head around. You know, I always say that, you know, all spirituality should grow corn. So for me, I kind of want everything to kind of have substance, have a sense of being able to work in this world and be able to move our lives forward. So I kind of found that hard to kind of digest. But when I kind of look at the experiences, they come to me, I never went to them. So, you know, maybe there's something in this. And I kind of connected to this energy, and I connected to the attributes of Odin, and it kind of rung true. And time went by, and it was kind of there, and it moved into the background, you know, the mediumship developed and unfolded, and it was kind of this sense of direct experience of moving people's lives forwards and my own life forwards. And that seemed what was very important to me, but it somehow was still in the background. Now, one particular time I was having a clear out myself, and I thought to myself, you know what, I'm not using these, and maybe it's wrong that they sit on my shelf. And I gave them to a friend at the time that was experimenting with Celtic oracles, and it just seemed right, and off they went. But what's interesting is that kind of experience never left me, to the point that I've got on my shoulder a very, very kind of large tattoo of what is Odin, and it's on my right side because he always appeared on my right side. So, you know, it left a mark on me, literally. Now, only in the last week or so, and this is what I'm talking about, alignment, okay, how things align for you. In the last week or so, I had a dream, the same dream that I had in Scotland all those many years ago. It was Saturday just gone, and I woke up in the morning with that clear experience, and kind of really kind of taken back by the experience because it was so vivid and very, very clear. And that much so, I shared it with Sarah and said, you know what, I got a sense that I'm kind of being called upon again, you know. The Wyrd, W-Y-R-D, is calling me again. And those of you who want to discover more about the Wyrd, check out The Way of the Wyrd by Brian Bates. The Wyrd is the energy that runs through all things, and especially within our land, it's just underneath the surface. You know, the myth, the stories, the legends are absolutely just under the surface. So I shared it with Sarah and said, you know, I think the Wyrd is calling me again, you know. The energy, the Odin is appeared again. And went on to make a coffee, and I'm checking their social media, and blow me, a good friend of ours, I'm on her Facebook, she had shared Odin's Gateway, understanding the runes. And I'm like, hold on a minute, you know, this is the second sign of the day. And I thought, well, hold on a minute, you know, this is really, really fascinating. Kind of done a little bit of kind of looking into Odin's Gateway, and thought, oh my word, you know, I'm being called, it's calling, it's come back to me. And was quite stoked by that, quite excited by that. Anyway, we kind of went off for the day, and I was spending time with some family, and some people we haven't seen for some time, and over a wonderful little spot that we get to share time at. And went over, and we got a brew on, we're cooking up some food and sharing. And then out of nowhere turns up a good friend of the family that I probably haven't seen in the best part of at least 6 or 7 years properly. And he's kind of looking out towards the pond and kind of enjoying the beautiful day that it was. And he starts reciting this poem. And this poem was a dedicated poem to Odin. And I'm just completely blown away by this experience, and kind of what's going on with it. And I'm like, hold on a minute. And it's just this beautiful poem about, a beautiful story about Odin. I'm going to try and get some of the audio for you and see if we can kind of share it as time goes forwards. But totally kind of speechless, you know, the third call of the day. So I kind of come back that day kind of really kind of digesting what this means. And one of the things that I've come to really discover is that, you know, the runes are very much, you know, kind of really, really embedded into the fabric of this landscape. They're just underneath the surface, and so are the stories and the tales. And I guess, you know, spending so much time outdoors in the world, in nature, that, you know, I'm kind of dropping back in, and it's almost like this sense of, in a way, going full circle. Sometimes within life we go full circle, but each time there's a deeper understanding, there's a deeper fabric to that, there's a a deeper substance to that. And for me, you know, there is this depth to it. Now, you know, I laughed earlier on because, you know, I said to you about the raven. Well, Odin often appears with two ravens. And the translation of their names are thought and memory. And I find just that fascinating. The story goes that his ravens go off into the world and bring back wisdom, bring back knowledge to him, bring back the news of the world. And he's this wanderer that wanders the land. And of course, for me, absolutely fits. It absolutely resonates. So I thought to myself, you know what? I need to kind of pick up the runes again. And then remembered that I gave them away, and I felt a little bit of sadness about that. But at the same time, I gave them with love, so it was the right thing to do, you know. They were not being used, and they should always be used. But I found my old runic book, which I've got here, and it is faded. The book is absolutely, the cover on it is totally faded. But what I found interesting was I opened it randomly. I'm thinking about, you know, should I get a set of runes? And when I opened it randomly, I've bookmarked it now, there it was making your own set of runes. And I was just like, hold on a minute, okay, there's the other nudge of the day. That my journey will be that I will make my own set of runes. So watch out, guys, as we kind of integrate that into things as they move forwards. And I'm going to share a little bit about the runes and making the runes and how you can kind of use them. And maybe we'll do some rune casting as well. But the whole kind of sense of what I wanted to share with you is that sometimes, you know, as life moves into alignment, the guidance is there, it comes to you. So as much as you look for it, I think it's really important to kind of just receive it, be open to what comes, be open to how things unravel, how things unfold. You know, sometimes we try to push things or we try to force things, but sometimes the most amazing things happen quietly. And they just kind of stir up and they kind of come to you very, very, very discreetly and very quietly. So, guys, I'm wishing you all the most amazing day, and I'll speak to you all very, very soon. Last thought, nearly forgot, but how could I forget? Day of the week, today, Wednesday. Randomly, strangely, oddly, look into the history of Wednesday, turns out to be Odin's day. Not random, maybe, who knows. And the other thing I want to share with you very quickly is the translation to the meaning of the runes is mystery or secret. Have a great day, guys. Take care. Bye.